And the next speaker is Wim Hermsen, who will talk about, in a sense, about his observations of a similar system.
Thank you very much. I'm continuing, let's say, the presentation on the mode-changing radio pulsars. And I would like to present you results from three campaigns and make a comparison toward the end. I list here my collaborators, which are mostly radio people, and Lucien Kuiper from the in the X-ray analysis. So the introduction more or less has been given by Sandro in his talk, and he also present, let's say, the first result, the results on the two campaigns on PSR 0943, and I will need then also continue with similar campaigns on PSR 1822 and on BO 823. The last one are very preliminary first results. In the end, I will have a comparison of all three. When I wrote the first proposal in 2006, in fact, it was still completely focusing on the what's happening at the polar cap. I got in the idea that if the X-rays would also mode together with the radio, it might tell me something about whether you are dealing here with inner accelerator caps, vacuum caps, or with space charge limited flow models. But after writing the first proposal, it took me 4 years before we finally got the data. We had those beautiful papers by Michael Kramer showing that indeed there was mode switching as a global magnetospheric phenomenon. He was showing that the new dot is changing and that indeed plasma streams were changing and it was global. There were two more papers later, 2012, seeing similar behavior for two more pulsars. And in 2010, when we got the first observations, Andrew Lyne had this very nice paper, and Sandro showed already the plots, where we could see that mode changing, pulse shape changing, was going together with new dot changes. At the same time, there was theoretical support that, let's say, the magnetosphere has global quasi-stable magnetospheric states. At the same time, there are papers that explain, let's say, the mode switching of the radio as a local phenomenon by discussing the inner acceleration gap. For instance, with partially screened cat models, and those models consider a critical temperature, and then it depends whether the temperature is just above the critical temperature or just below, whether you have a partially screening of the inner accelerator cap. So that was very exciting, and these are then the three pulsars I'm going to present results. The first pulsar, 0943, Sandro showed this very nicely. This is a neatly lined pulsar. There we discovered, in fact, that the X-rays and radio change mode together, an old pulsar. And when you compare it with the other two, this one looks very much like PSRB0823, which are about the same age, and that the field at the surface is factor two the same. The E dot, rotation energy loss, is close. That's different from PSRB1822, which is very much younger. And much more energetic, has a stronger magnetic field. This one is nearly aligned. This one we take as being orthogonal based on the fact that we see a pulse and likely an interpulse, but okay, there are other views on this in the radio community, also by Nikitina and Malov. 0823, that is also based on the radio parameters, an orthogonal pulsar. Just to show you the moding, types of moding, here is B0943 with low far, it's in a bright mode, suddenly quiet and then bright. Here's GMRT, you see again, here's the quiet mode, bright mode. The interesting thing is there is also a precursor in front of this main pulse, of this pulse, and that is correlating, in fact, in anti-correlation with the main pulse. So when the main pulse is bright, the precursor is on and is off and is on when the bright main pulse is quiet. This shows the moding. Okay, what is important to realize that the mode durations are typically hours here. For the second pulsar, P1820209, you see there's a main pulse and there's an interpulse, and that leads us to the assumption that this is an orthogonal rotator. We see both poles, and there's a precursor as well. We see the main pulse is moding from a bright mode to quiescent mode. The interesting thing is that here the interpulse is moding in anti-correlation. So when the main pulse is bright, it's off. When the main pulse is quiet, it's on. And that was already discussed in many papers. How do the two poles know of each other that they mode at the same time and then in anti-correlation? And there's no explanation yet. It's interesting to see there's also a precursor. And in this case, let's say the interpulse and the main pulse correlate in anti-correlation. The precursor in this case goes together with the bright mode. And here, the mode durations are typically minutes. And so the average will be about 4 or 5 minutes, then it's switching again. The last one, PSR B1822. Here you see an example from Lover observations, so et al., a recent paper. Here you see it's very bright. There's the main pulse. There's a much weaker interpulse. And here's a post cursor. And you see here it was originally a nulling pulsar. They discovered here with Lover that, in fact, the nulling is not a null, but it's normally in a quiescent state, so a weak state. In fact, sometimes they still say it appears to be off, that is nulling. So there are different states. For us, let's say the Q state and off state we call Q state, and there's the bright state. Interesting, they're all different. Here the main pulse, interpulse, and post cursor show correlated switches. They're all on or they're all off. Sander already presented the result for B0943. So the interesting thing there is indeed that we have in the Q mode, it's brighter than in the B mode. The thermal emission goes down by a factor of 3, the non-thermal emission by a factor of 2, but it's anti-correlation. So when the radio is bright, the X-rays are weak. It has a very broad profile, and the pulse fraction in the Q mode is getting very high, and that is very difficult to explain. Sander mentioned, let's say, a possibility. 0943, you look continuously to the pole, and how can you get then a pulsation of up to 60%, because you should see something which is almost flat. And there, indeed, the magnetic field is sufficiently strong to have magnetic beaming. And indeed, that you have a pencil beam then and a broad fan light beam. We have here some references. Now, this could be an explanation. So then the campaign on 1822. We had 200 kiloseconds of maximum Newton observations end of 2013 and March 2014. We had simultaneous observations with Westerbork, and it was also supported by Lovell and GMRT, because particularly in this case, when you mode every 5 minutes, you always have to know exactly in what radio mode it is. So you must really have always coverage. So if one of those radio telescopes would have RFI or wouldn't work for a moment, we could have the other. And indeed, we detected the source very neatly. But in fact, we did see a double source. For the low energies, below 1.4 keV, the pulsar is dominating. Above 1.4 keV, there's a nearby source at 5 arc seconds. So you can only analyze this properly when you have used maximum likelihood, and that works nicely. We also discovered for this source pulsations that is shown here. And let's say this is again a broad profile. You have here the main pulse, the precursor position, and the interpulse position. This is background subtracted. There's no background. These are all counts from the pulsar. As you see, it's broad, and the X-ray pulse is lacking by 0.1 in phase. The pulse fraction over this total X-ray range, 0.2 till, let's say, 2 kV, is 35%. So 35% is in this pulse, and the rest is below. And we don't see here, let's say, structure at the interpulse. But that is not strange, because you should realize, if they both emit, and one is strong and one is weak, it sums up to this profile. So it doesn't tell us now that we don't have emission from the interpulse. When we determine the pulse fraction now as a function of energy, we see that it's getting very high, around 1 keV. And it shows, first of all, that the pulsed emission has a much harder spectrum than the unpulsed emission. But let's say for an orthogonal rotator, when both poles are seen, you should not have, when you have just isotropic thermal emission, such high pulse fractions. That's impossible. And let's say, in that respect, I will come back to that later. We also think that here also somehow of magnetic beaming should play a role, or we should have other explanations. We looked for mode switching, and this is an example of our data, radio data. Here you see the pulse, main pulse, precursor, interpulse. Here you see the detection signal-to-noise ratio of the precursor. And you see really on, off, on, off. The main pulse is high when the precursor is on, as weak when the pulse precursor is off. And the interpulse is doing this in anti-correlation. And in fact, we selected this on the precursor because there we have the cleanest separation of the two modes. We did make many tests whether we see evidence for mode switching. I show you only this last one. We don't see evidence in this case for mode switching. And here we show, let's say, the pulse profiles in both modes, background subtracted, and the fact that they are on top of each other and they are drawn from the same parent distribution at the 97% level. We can say that the end pulse shape and flux of the pulse emission doesn't change, and flux of the unpulsed emission. We made additional checks, but we don't see any evidence for mode switching. Then the spectra. The total emission we can very nicely explain with two black bodies, and other fits with power loss do not give a proper description. And what we have there, we have two black bodies, a cool one, is 0.08 kV or 0.96 million Kelvin with a large radius if you take a black body fit, and a hot one with a 100 meter radius. And this is 2.2 million Kelvin. And this is not strange because this is a pulsar 200,000 years old, a bit similar like the Schirmer's Curtius, Geminga, 0656 and 1052. They also have two black bodies. They have, in addition, a power law, but that is much weaker. And if you would scale it, it would be below our upper limits. In fact, when we now fit the pulsed emission and the unpulsed emission as well, we have proper fits with the same temperatures and similar radii. And let's say, if I draw now a cartoon, the data is consistent with emission from both poles. And hot, let's say, two hot pulses, one strong, one weak, and two cool pulses with different ratios, and they can give us then the total result. Let me say, then the point indeed is, how do we get indeed those differences of the two? And that again, if it's really an orthogonal rotator, it's difficult, or you really have to work with very different temperatures on either poles. Or again, you have to start thinking about magnetic beaming, where indeed the cooler component has a broader beam and can be seen from both poles almost the same at the same strength, a little bit stronger from the main poles. And you have then a narrower, hotter beam for the hotter component. So indeed, I said it already. You see then two components, one from the primary spot and one from the interpulse with the same radius. And then a cool component, you see indeed from both poles, 30% more from the main pulse than the interpulse. Then I'd like to switch to the new campaign. And there we had 170,000 XMM Newton seconds. This year, so it's really fresh, end of April. And we had this together with GMRT, supported partly by LOFAR. And here you see indeed the mode switching I showed you earlier. And then the first observation in April, we indeed had a beautiful bright state in radio. Here you see 22 minutes in this case, but we have some like 7.5 hours of XMM observations in each observation. And beautiful profile. And during the whole observation, it was in B mode. Second observation as well. But the third observation, it was for 7-8 hours in the quiescent mode. Except of one occasion here, this is only 6 minutes, where there was bright emission. And the radio analysis showed that this was apparently a null state. There was bright emission, and then it was fading. This was only 6 minutes, and it was in radio less intense than during the bright mode, but it was clearly there. But for the rest, it was a completely quiescent observation. And the later observations, again, they were always in the radio bright mode. So we had 5 observations in radio bright mode and 1 in Q mode. In the first and the second observation, we nicely detected the source. This is a raw map. But on April the 24th, when it was in the quiet mode, we did not see the source and the count rate was consistent to 0. The next day, or the second day after, in the radio bright mode, we do see again the X-rays. And it was also the 28th and the 30th. In fact, it was bingo. We did see again simultaneous X-ray radio mode switching. So this is the second case that we discovered this. This was wonderful. But in this case, it are correlated switches. Radio bright with X-ray bright, radio quiet with X-ray quiet. So the opposite to what we see for 0943. In fact, I show here the count rates for the 6 observations in 1 hour time intervals. And this is the average for all bright modes. And this is the average for the Q mode. And you see that already the X-rays can tell us in what state the radio is. That's pretty exciting. You see some hint of a decay, of these are a bit lower and this one is higher. This is all new for the last weeks. So we have to investigate the radio in more detail. But here the interesting thing is in the Q mode, the average is consistent with 0, but there's a hint that there is, it's not always 0. When we now zoom in, you get this situation. This is the whole observation in Q mode. And here you have this bright mode, and we call this bright Q. And this is exactly this band. So the radio Q mode, it seems that we suddenly have a flux, higher flux here, and that it goes down. Triggered by these 6 minutes in radio in bright Q mode. In fact, when I select this bin, and this bin is 21 minutes, and I make a sky map, I have a 4.4 sigma detection, so we really detect the source, it's significant. Here it's getting weaker, but when I combine these 4 points, it's also more than 4 sigma. So even though the total observation gives 0, consistent with 0, we see indeed that something happened triggered by the radio upturn in the bright Q mode. And that's pretty exciting that you really see a very tight correlation. And we have now to analyze this in more detail. As I said earlier, the first quick analysis was this was a null and then bright and then it was fading over such a period. And this could be followed by the X-rays. And I remember you this figure, because this figure was published. Here it was called B, It's clearly weaker in a radio than there. They said, hey, is it off here? And there's Q. And that's exactly what we think we have seen here, a null mode. Something happens, also in X-rays, and it's fading. So we found this indeed pretty exciting. We also discovered, for this pulsar now, moding of pulsations in the bright mode. So this is the light curve. Here you have the main pulse, the post-cursor, and the interpulse. And now the X-ray is lacking by 0.2 in phase. Again, it's a broad profile. And from this, this is a very, very, I think, exciting, that we have indeed now synchronous and correlated radio X-ray moding. In the bright radio mode, we have X-ray brightness with very strong pulsation. In a Q mode, we have no X-ray emission, at least with our statistics, except when we are in that, this bright Q mode. And the pulse fraction effect in the B mode is very high, almost 80%. This is a low value, but it's very large error bars. And this for an orthogonal rotator. How do we get such enormous pulse fractions? Also there, you start to think about magnetic beaming, I must say. But okay, so this is again very odd. I said already these are first results. Up to now it's not ambiguous because these are, results are there. We started the spectral analysis. And there, let's say, the total emission cannot be fitted with single power or no black, single black body. Clear. And we have very nice spectral fits with two black bodies, again a cooler and a hotter one, with small radii. When we take this black body fit, indeed. So this is an explanation similar to 1822. But I must say, that's why I say it's preliminary. The total emission we can also fit with a 10% probability with a black body plus power law. With this temperature, 0.3 keV, small radius, and an index of minus 2.5. However, in this case, we get exactly the same values for the total, and maybe take just the pulsed emissions. In this case, when we fit the pulsed emission, it is not consistent. And this we have to study a little bit more in detail. As I could say now already, and it's particularly important for the interpretation, because you get a completely different discussion, these numbers are exactly the same as we found for 0943. So that would be exciting if that is the case, but it would also be exciting if that is the final fit. And the shape of the pulsed and unpulsed spectra are within statistics the same. It's clear with this large pulse fraction that the number of counts in the unpulsed emission is low. Again, here we can explain, let's say, this as a sum of two profiles, an interpulse and a main pulse. Of course, it's a bit shifted compared to the radio by 0.2. Let's say both pulses have a cool component and a hot component of 1.4 million Kelvin and 4.3 million Kelvin. In fact, this cartoon is not completely correct. This dip should be deeper in this case. Alternatively, lower probability, we have to see whether that is really consistent with all the data, that we have two pulses, both with a black body and a power law. And that would be similar to 0943, and okay, that we have to work out now further. But let's say now to compare the three pulsars, moding pulsars. 0943, we have synchronous radio and X-ray correlations, but anti-correlated. And here the mode lengths are hours. 0823, again, synchronous radio X-ray correlations, but they are correlated. Also, mode lengths of hours. On average, a bit longer, but hours. 1822, no moding, short mode lengths of minutes. And we have been thinking maybe you need more time to get a stable situation, because if you mode every 4 or 5 minutes, maybe that's the reason why we don't see it. On the other hand, 0823, we see a reaction already when we have only 6 minutes of radio bright. But But this we have to study now in more detail, the radio, whether indeed when, in this case, the X-rays are fading, whether in the same way the radio are fading. All three pulsars have broad thermal sinusoidal X-ray pulses with high pulse fractions. And that's difficult to explain with near aligned and orthogonal geometries in both cases. It's just not thermal isotopic emission. X-ray emission from PSR 1822 can be explained as emission from opposite poles, each with cool and hot components. 0823 similarly, but as I said, we will look again somewhat detailed whether this would be equally likely, but this is giving at the moment a consistent result. And for 0843, indeed, we have there thermal and non-thermal emission. Well, then a question: how are the X-ray, is the X-ray moding related to the radio moding? Is this global? Is this local? I'm not sure yet, because we really have to explain. It's one of the questions asked: why are these different when the one is bright and the other is quiescent, and vice versa? Sandro is right that you might see only certain parts of the beam, but let's say when you have global changes, that might also cause changes of the profile. Cannot be absorption, because let's say this exact state is repeated every 5 minutes, 6 minutes, 7 minutes, or every 10 hours. So you always come back to exactly the same radio state as you had, it was in the past. I have two more slides, if you allow me. I found this also very exciting and would just like to show you this. PSR 1822, our Westerbork observations, we have long observations because we need that for the X-rays. And these are the mode length intervals. And this is a continuous distribution. And this is from 10 seconds to 15 minutes. And you see that most modes have a duration of 4 or 5 minutes. And a short tail to, with a tail to 15 minutes. So that's very smooth. And this is summing up all modes. If I now make two distributions, one for the Q mode and one for the B mode, they're not the same at all. They add up to something very smooth, and these are completely different. And it looks like you have maxima and trough, some valleys. And this is a whole discussion, but I will keep it short. Let's say PSRB 1822 can also has radio properties that you see a rotating carousel. You could make that interpretation. Just like 0943, in a bright mode, you have a very regular rotating carousel at the surface. And you have there the subpulse modulation P3. This has been also detected in a Q mode, a strong modulation. In this case, long period, much longer than 0943. And that modulation is 46.55 times the period of the pulsar. In the B mode, there's a weak modulation. And these are apparently harmonically related, vector 2 to 3, and there that modulation is 70 times P. And when you now look to the arrows, it looks like you see a maximum and a minimum at multiples of those modulations, which are different at the two poles, and these are indeed harmonically related. We can discuss this at length, but the idea is now that you have a duration, a period, which is really tied to the surface, a local phenomenon, and you have a period, you have mode durations, which is something global. So again, this somehow hints to a global effect. I think the overall discussion, are we dealing here with local effects or global effects, radio X-rays? I think this discussion open, it's pretty exciting. Thank you.
Thank you, Wim. Questions, please.
Ali.
Sergei.
Um, sorry if I missed it. Are angles between spin and magnetic axis independently known for these sources? And if yes, how precisely?
The spin axis, magnetic axis. Let's say 0823, I think that is a very clear case in the radio that it's orthogonal. L943, I think everybody agrees that it's, I think, 9 and 15 degrees. So they really look to the... Uh-huh. And 1822, we have in our paper, which appeared in January, an appendix where we discuss, let's say, all the radio data. And we agree with our Russian colleagues, Nikitina and Malov, that you cannot really conclude what we finally conclude, that given that we have there the main pulse and interpulse at 180 degrees, that is orthogonal. But there you might think that maybe it's at 16 degrees what they get. Even then, it's problematic to get these pulse fractions.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
More questions?
Aline.
Sandra?
On the spectrum, or at least on the flux of the hard source near 1822?
Not the top of my head. Let's say, it's dominating above 1.4 kV, and then, so the question, what is it? And it could be something that has to do with the pulse of the nebula, but that's something to look into. Yeah. And we, in fact, submitted once a proposal and didn't get time with Sandra. Because you wanted to... you don't have many counts. It's dominating above 1.4, so we have something. Yeah, I don't know the top of my head. Ali?
Ali, can you please give mic?
What are the X-ray luminosities of these three pulsars, and are they similar to each other and different regarding the X-ray output of other radio pulsars?
I think these are a bit similar. These are all old till middle-age pulsars, and these are a bit similar, so 10 to the 29, 30. Let's say in this case, the few good candidates to do this work are these old pulsars, which are very weak X-ray sources. So that's why we sometimes see this source for the first time or detect the pulsations for the first time because of the long observations.
Okay, more questions? No more questions? Okay, then let's thank the speaker again.